So, good to have all of you here, and always enjoy this opportunity to see the hams, and I've been thinking about this as it's been a remarkable spring in Wyoming, and as I've traveled across the state looks great, and almost everywhere it's been so green, but we've had some amazing, crazy weather as well, and I'm sure all of you saw the pictures. We weren't there, the tornado outside of Laramie, close to Laramie, it was made heard about national and international news. We had the very scary fire over in the Medicine Bow, 20,000 plus acres. Just last night here in Cheyenne, we had pea size or even larger hail. And I think about those things combined with the state has been working with some of our state agencies and the Homeland Security on, you know, the reliability of the grid system, and you know, what do you do in a statewide emergency if the grid goes down, and all these plans. And I think I've mentioned this to you all before, is that the first thing that happens on major natural disasters is you lose communication. And when I was U.S. attorney and they had that devastating, terrible hurricane in New Orleans, the U.S. attorney from New Orleans gave all the other U.S. attorneys a presentation. And he said, you know, we had manuals after manuals on what you do. And they always started with, you contact this person, you contact this person, you contact Washington, D.C. He said, we had no communication. Cell phones down, landlines. And so on all of these things, whether it's a natural disaster, whether it's limited in scope to a region or a town, whether it is a fire or it's flood, whether it's an attack, you know, the communications is so critical. And you can't, it's sort of step one on getting anything done. So I've been thinking about that as we've had the sort of the crazy spring weather, along with a lot of moisture, we've had the fire. It seemed don't go together, but so much appreciate all of you being here. In Wyoming, we have, I think, roughly 2,000 people operating ham radios. And so it's great to have all of you in. Appreciate what you do. And I know all of you would say, in addition to the ability for that communication as would be needed, you also have a lot of fun. That's an important component to all of it as well. Now, before I sign the proclamation, I'm interested to hear from any of you, and I'd be interested to hear what we've got here.
Oh, well, that's mine.
Yeah.
I'm legally blind, so I can't drive a car, but I can drive a bicycle, mm-hmm. and I love the greenway system in this town, by the way. I used to run a CB radio on my bike years ago. Mm-hmm. So when I got my first handheld, I said, well, why don't I put it on my bike? So I have a 8-watt, what's called a handy talkie, mm-hmm. and speaker mic, which is completely waterproof, hooked to a good antenna, and I ride around town with this a lot, talk to some of these guys usually, and
can you talk while you're riding?
Oh yeah.
Can you?
Yeah. This is on a magnet. I just easy enough to pick up and put back. I'm working on a slide.
This is a battery pack here?
No, that's my handlebar bag. That's got all my stuff in it that I need for every day. No, the battery is on here, and it's a rechargeable.
Oh.
And lasts about, well, I don't think I've ever run a battery down. When you're listening, it takes up very little power. Mm. So it only uses power when you transmit. So, yeah, it's pretty simple, pretty straightforward. I am working on a slightly better, bigger rig to put on this, but I need a battery first.
I'm just impressed that you can ride that bicycle with all that on there.
Well, it didn't start with all this on here. This is a work in progress. I've had it since 2007. Mm-hmm. So I keep making adjustments, adding stuff, taking stuff off, putting stuff on, flag.
Nice.
Put a light up there so when I right out to Archer, the trucks at Sap Brothers can see me at night.
Rides all the way out to EMA to Archer to go to the meetings and stuff like that, so we keep up with him. We know where he's at.
Very nice.
Yeah, we've got a couple of really good repeaters in this town.
I was going to say, I was in Katrina. I was in Meridian, Mississippi. You know, absolutely right. Communications totally went down. The only thing that worked was my ham radio to contact my family and have somebody contact them up in Pennsylvania. Tell them I was okay. And that, but that was a pretty bad situation. And I agree with you. There's absolutely no communication.
Well, how much was that worth for your family to hear you were okay?
It was worth plenty. And I, you know, of course, made calls for other people.
Sure.
But, they underutilized down there. And nobody was organizing the ham. You know, the state didn't utilize them. So.
Well, it's part of the reason the proclamation, I think, is important is because the description I got from the U.S. Attorney about Katrina was they eventually got amateur radio people involved, but even their Homeland Security people didn't, it didn't occur to them whether they could leverage that resource in a way. So they got it, and then they got their cells back and everything else, but it's something that should be on the forefront, particularly of those who have to plan for those events, is that resource.
As I became a ham radio operator, I always lived by the motto, when all else fails. That's our ham radio motto, is when all else fails, ham radio goes there through everything.
Hurricane Maria was a good point of interest for amateur radio and really brought them to the forefront. The Red Cross requested 50 amateur radio operators to go down to Puerto Rico because there was absolutely no communications at all down there.
Yeah, that's a good example.
So, they went down and they did a great job. Several of them were working the command center, taking messages from the guys in the field. There were guys watching the dam. There were people out on health and welfare around the island. And for a couple of weeks, that was the only communications they had to talk because their infrastructure was so destroyed down there. And they did a great job.
It's a great story in that it's not only the ability to operate it, but the willingness to step in and help out. That's
absolutely
a wonderful story.
Absolutely, and those guys are champions.
Yep.
As far as the nation, goes. I mean, they were the ones that were talking and talking back to the states on HF, and saying here's what we need, here's the situation, sending message back on digital if they can get through. It was amazing.
Yeah.
So they did a great job.
Yeah, that's a good example.
The man from the league that organized that, Mike Corey, is coming to our convention in Rock Springs the 15th of September and will be our keynote speaker.
Well, please pass on my congratulations and thanks. That's great you're getting here.
We're excited about our theme is emergency preparedness and communication.
Good.
So we're excited about that.
Well, excellent. Now that would be well attended.
Yes.
Hopefully. Good for you for getting him. I suspect he's in high demand.
Yes, he is. Yeah. We also have a speaker I met in Yuma at another ham meet that was one of the hams that went to Puerto Rico, and he gives a seminar on what it was like to really be in the trenches. Mm-hmm. He was kind of cool too, but he's supposed to come to Rock Springs also.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Good deal.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, thank you all very much. Highlight this proclamation as much as you can for the rest of Wyoming. So.
Absolutely. Yep.
All right, Governor's Proclamation. Whereas Wyoming's amateur radio operators work with federal, state, and local emergency service organizations to provide emergency radio communications during severe weather, natural disasters, and power outages, and whereas Wyoming is home to more than 2,000 radio amateurs, And whereas Wyoming recognizes and appreciates the diligence of these hams, who also serve as weather spotters in the Sky Warn program of the U.S. Government Weather Bureau, and whereas Wyoming radio amateurs generously donate time and equipment to provide communication support to local service clubs, organizations, and charities, and whereas Wyoming's radio amateurs continue to improve their communication skills and will operate the 24-hour emergency simulation known as Field Day on June 23rd, 24th, 2018. Now therefore, I, Matthew H. Mead, Governor of the State of Wyoming, do hereby proclaim June 18th through the 24th, 2018 as Amateur Radio Week in Wyoming. Congratulations, thank you. Chris, we'd love to get a photo.
You bet.
And maybe what we could do is move the desk up and we could get it by our mobile unit here.
That'll work.
Oh. If everybody wants to kind of fill in back here. Okay. I can take one with yours too, if you'd like. Oh, there's just stand by your mom.
Yeah.
How's that?
You know, speaking of power outages, it's amazing how used to power we get. We lost power in our house for 10 minutes the other day, and you know, you just don't even, you know, it's such an adjustment. You try to turn up, you turn a light in one room, doesn't work, you go to the next one, you just can't even get in your head not to have power.
LED lights everywhere, those portable ones you can get at Harbor Freight or whatever.
Yeah. They last forever. Yeah, they last forever.
And yeah, just gotta have them.
Okay.
All right, everyone, here we go. One, two, three, couple more. I'm gonna take some with this camera.
Yeah, you have to get back a little farther.
Oh yeah.
Gotta fit in my mic.
That's all right. Okay, one, two, three, couple more. All right.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. What you do.
Good
to see you. Thank you.
Good to see you too.
Yeah, appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm glad you got to see Ruth.
Yes.